When it comes to comedy, sometimes simplicity works best. Situational comedies, sitcoms for short, are a prime example. While there are exceptions, most sitcoms center around the lives of ordinary individuals, usually friends or extended family. Running from 1996 to 2005, Everybody Loves Raymond is one such sitcom. Inspired by the comedy of star Ray Romano, the show centers around successful New York journalist Ray Barone, his wife Deborah, their three children, and his extended family, who live right across the street. Most of the comedy and drama is derived from this setup and is accentuated by the characters and their personalities. Ray loves his wife, but is a mama's boy. Deborah puts up with Ray's quirks and hobbies, but hates her mother-in-law's overbearing intrusions. While it would be interesting to dissect and review the series as a whole, that's a project for another time. Instead, I'm going to count down my top favorite episodes from the series, narrowing the list to 10. This list isn't ranked, but I will explain what qualities help each episode make the list. Remember, this is my personal opinion, so please keep discussions civil. Number 10, Frank Goes Downstairs. The sixth episode of season 6, Ray and Deborah each suffer a minor injury when they fall out of bed during sex. Ray brags about it to his friends the following day, but drops the subject when his father comes over. Gianni can't let it lie, so he brings the subject up in front of Frank. Instead of telling the truth, Ray lies and says he and Deborah fell down the stairs because they're old and rickety. Frank sets to work, but falls through the stairs in the middle of his repairs. Ray naturally feels guilty, as his lie put his father in the hospital, so he confesses to Frank. After the fall, Ray's confession is the highlight. Ray is bearing his soul to his father, who wouldn't care under normal circumstances, and his confession is complicated by Frank's painkiller high, which causes him to ramble in an uncharacteristic manner.
I liked it when you moved in across the street. Because I could come to your house, you could come to my house. Not too much, just doing stuff, watching a game, playing some pool. By the way, one of us should get a pool table.
It makes for easy comedy, as well as one of my favorite Frank Barone moments.
Could I tell you a story?
Yeah, sure.
One night, your mother had a little too much Kahlua.
No, Dad, no.
But it's story time.
No, look.
While funny, the episode touches on the different relationships an individual has and how one talks differently between them. Makes one want to weigh words and reactions more carefully. Number 9. The Kicker. Another season 6 episode, The Kicker was one of the first episodes I watched with my grandmother and helped me get a grasp on the characters and their relationships with one another. While attending a college football game, Frank catches a football from a record-setting field goal and refuses to return it to the school. He is lambasted by the radio media, but Frank fires back by calling one of the shows.
Boy, hot topic. Lines are lit up. Let's go to Frank in Lynbrook.
Yeah, this is the jackass. I caught that ball, and anybody who doesn't like it can kiss me between the back pockets.
Are you kidding me?
Ray and the others attempt to take the ball back by force, but Frank manages to thwart their plans. Ray eventually brings in the kicker and his father to help, and Frank finally returns the ball. Everybody Loves Raymond episodes often dealt with family relationships, and The Kicker is no exception, focusing on the father-son dynamic. Frank and Ray have differing opinions regarding the ball, causing them to clash. After the direct approach doesn't work, Ray writes an article about the situation, stating that while his father gave him his love of sports, Frank's personal greed is clouding his enjoyment in love. While Frank doesn't read the article, meeting the kicker and his father, and seeing the same transferred love of sport, helps Frank see past his greed. Of course, Frank being Frank, he has to leave an exclamation point.
You see that?
Yeah.
You see how nice that kid was to his father? You owe me 10 grand!
One other thing to note is that Frank outs Ray as his son when he calls the radio show, and Ray's reaction speaks for itself. Number 8. Liers. The 7th episode of Season 8, Liers is the only entry on the list I saw during first run, and definitely helped set my love of the series in stone. Having stood his mother up the night before, Ray lied, telling Marie he had a headache. From there, the situation snowballs, with Ray and Deborah telling lie after lie to cover up the first one. In the end, Marie unravels it all in a Holmes-ish manner, and storms off hurt. The lies provide most of the episode's comedy, but as the third act unfolds, Ray and Deborah begin to mistreat distrust each other, paranoia ruling. This paranoia causes Ray to act irrationally and is the catalyst for Marie's deductions. Dr. House said it best, everybody lies. The only variable is how often and how grandiose. That makes Ray's predicament relatable, especially given his mother's nature. Marie loves to blow things out of proportion, and we all know at least one individual like that. It makes the audience wonder what they would do in his situation. Tell the truth from the get-go and get it over with, or lie. Number 7. The Can Opener. The second episode of Season 4, this episode heavily deals with marital arguments. The morning following an argument, Ray and Deborah both tell their version of the story to Marie and Robert respectively. As one would expect, each story heavily favors the teller, providing for fantastical comedy. The two seemingly make up afterwards, but the argument is reunited when Marie butts in. Things continue when Frank arrives, and he reveals that he and Marie had a similar argument earlier in their marriage over a jar of fat, which leads to a discussion on marital appreciation and one of the best Frank outbursts of the series.
I wanted to thank you. Where was my thank you? I waltzed in, huh? I dragged my ass home every day after 10 hours stuck in a suit, stuck in an office, stuck in a car, and if I needed coins to pay the tolls that got me to that job, that paid for that meat, that made that fat, then I'll dump it out whenever I want, and I don't care what you say.
As I said, the episode deals with marital arguments, showing that they can start over the simplest and stupidest of reasons. If there's a moral lesson, it's that while resentments can last and eventually boil over, sometimes an argument is just an argument. Get it out, come to an understanding, and move on. The dual story segment is also a perfect example of the truth being in the middle. Ray and Deborah both twist the facts to suit their agendas, and the audience sees right through the ploy. Number 6. Ping Pong. Now we come to the first of many Season 3 episodes. Before I dig into the episode proper, I must confess that this is my favorite season, and the beginning of the show's high point, which lasted until Season 5. Not to say the earlier or later seasons are bad, but they don't have the same creative wit and stamina as a whole. Episode 13 of this season, Ping Pong, revolves around Ray finding out that Frank let him win the last time they played. Annoyed at the prospect, Ray challenges his father to a rematch, which Frank accepts after some prodding. The two play, and Frank easily wins, gloating the whole time. To score an emotional victory, Ray lies and says he let Frank win, which angers Frank, causing him to storm out. This leads to an emotional father-son conversation in the kitchen, where Frank reveals not only why he taught his sons the game, but that Ray did beat him fairly the last time. This is one of Frank's most heartfelt moments, and shows that he does love Ray, even if he's not comfortable showing it all the time. The episode balances comedy and drama well, shifting back and forth as the plot unfolds. Not only does this carry the story's message forward, but it allows Peter Boyle to show off his timing and acting ability. Number 5. Good Girls. Taking place near the end of the second season, this episode is about family secrets and the implications of their reveal. With Robert and Amy's first dating anniversary approaching, Marie announces she's letting Amy prepare a family dinner in her kitchen. This draws Ray's attention and jealousy, as Deborah has never been granted the same honor. After a brief argument with Robert, Frank lets it slip that Marie likes Amy more than Deborah, which gets their attention and plays on their self-esteems. Ray later confronts his mother, a scene Romano and producer Rosenthal revealed on the audio commentary was a spoof on then-President Clinton.
I know you're not saying it now, but did you say it ever? What if I told you that we have a tape of you saying it, Mom?
Give me the tape.
Amy is still a virgin, or good girl. From there, things move forward, leading to the show's biggest revelation to that point.
I take exception to that, Deborah.
Well, I take exception to what you think, Marie. You think just because you were a good girl in the 50s, that gives
good
you the
girl.
Right...
Good girl! Oh, Frank, no!
What the hell are you talking about?
Is that true, Marie? Go ahead, Marie. I won't tell anyone.
Okay, yes.
Not only does this make Marie a hypocrite and undermine her reasoning for liking Amy better, but it makes the audience rethink everything she's done to Deborah. Could self-loathing be involved? This revelation also means that Robert is responsible for Frank and Marie's marriage, which wasn't uncommon at the time. Adds the right amount of additional irony to this situation. After everything's settled, the episode does have a charming ending, which is the perfect way to end the soap operatic night. Number 4. Lone Barone. The second season 3 episode of the list, Robert has moved out of his parents' house and is now settling into an apartment. Amy is happy for him, but he is starting to feel pressured by her subtle marital hints, as this is the first time he's truly been on his own and wants to slowly transition. He goes to Ray for advice, but Ray doesn't notice this and does nothing but complain about marriage, as Deborah has put him on mail watch duty on his one day off. Robert takes this bad advice and confronts Amy off screen, leading to their breakup. Naturally, everyone is angry at Ray as they view his bad advice as the catalyst for the whole affair. Ray has a talk with Robert in front of everyone, which leads to one of the show's many monologues on marriage.
Look, this is marriage. You wake up in the morning and she's there. You come home at night and she's there. You eat, she's there. You go to sleep, there. And I know that sounds like a bad thing, but it's not. It's not. Not if it's the right person. Then it's good. It's good. It's really, really good.
This episode marked the first time Amy and Robert's relationship was seriously tested, a plot thread that would pop up now and again over the next 4 seasons. Number 3. Robert's Wedding. The finale of season 7, this episode finally sees Robert and Amy tie the knot, and as one would expect, it's anything but a normal day. Robert is nervous beforehand, Raymond hasn't written his best man toast, and to top it off, the priest is missing. He eventually turns up, but Marie interrupts the ceremony during the "speak now or forever hold your peace" part, giving the couple a lecture about marrying only for love. The reception begins with some tension between the newlyweds' parents, but it passes once Ray gives his stream of consciousness toast, which is both funny and heartfelt. While I didn't start to watch the show until after this episode aired, watching the show in order on DVD helped me appreciate it more. It's a culmination of a plot thread that has ebbed and flowed since season 1. Robert and Amy have been through many trials and tribulations to get to this point. Countless breakups, broken hearts, and awkward situations. While not an easy road, it has made them stronger as both a couple and as individuals. Marie's interjection is to be expected, as she is a clingy mother. Even though she wanted the pair to marry, she can't help but give her 2 cents, even justifying it. Despite this, the final thing she says is good advice, even if it lacks some impact considering the circumstances of her and Frank's own nuptials. Number 2. No Fat. Season 3 is here again. After having their cholesterol checked and finding it dangerously high, Marie decides it's time to adjust her cooking style to improve her and Frank's health. Thanksgiving is approaching, and she decides to apply her new style to dinner, which results in a tofu turkey at the table. Everyone seemingly is going along with Marie's plan, but a knock at the door reveals that Ray had ordered a backup dinner, hurting his mother's feelings. The two have a heart-to-heart in the kitchen, and all is forgiven, for now. With how Marie had behaved in the first 2 seasons, changing up her cooking style is something unexpected, but her justification for doing so makes sense. Frank's reaction to each change is priceless, and he has some excellent one-liners.
What's better for you?
Don't give me better! Look, it's not even mixing. The coffee doesn't even recognize it.
Why do you assume it's me?
Because you're the one who wants to kill me.
Okay. But I still didn't order this.
May I have my carving knife, please?
Thank you, Frank.
I want to slit my throat.
Ray and Marie's talk near the end is very touching and adds some depth to their relationship. Without giving spoilers, the ending scene is predictable, but the right way. It revives the status quo while not making the change meaningless. Number 1, Ray's Home Alone. I told you there'd be a lot of season 3 on this list. Episode 18 of that season, Ray is left home alone when Deborah takes the kids to Connecticut to visit her parents. Normally, Ray would revel in this situation, but once his friends leave, he finds it difficult to sleep in an empty house. He goes over to Robert's, interrupting a date in the process. He then heads to his parents, where he finds both awake and Robert. Turns out they both have the same problem on this night. The episode centers around childhood fears, both of what the mind is assumes is hiding in the dark, and what other people tell us is so. We learn how the Barone family handled this subject as Ray and Robert grew up, giving us insight into how they developed. Frank was eager to scare the two, whereas Marie was eager to coddle them. This aspect is brought out in the present, where Marie is eager to help her sons with their current issue, and Frank revels in exploitation. Like any scorned individuals, the brothers attempt to get even with Frank, which backfires wonderfully. Highlight of the episode, and a prime example of why this is the show's high point. That concludes the countdown.